right, and Max, are you going to hand out, give the handout?
Oh, yeah. By the way, for the record, I'm the instructor, I'm Max Oshu.
All right. As Max said, I'm Dr. Catherine Gulke, and today we are going to be talking about the Wisconsin Association of Free and Charitable Clinics and Safety Net. First, I'll begin with talking about myself, then we'll review what a free and a charitable clinic is and how it's different from other safety net providers such as the Federally Qualified Health Center or Rural Health Center. Then we will talk about the documentary. We'll watch it. I understand Max maybe showing you 6 minutes. We'll watch the rest of it. We'll talk about the healthcare gap that remains. Where we are right now with the law, where we might be going with the law, and how that will impact the safety net. We will talk about the role of an association and why having an association is important. We'll be talking about our association's mission and purpose, other associations, and then any questions that you guys might have. Feel free to raise your hand throughout my presentation if something comes to you, though. All right, this is me. Back when I was thin, before I broke my ankle and quit exercising, but I don't want to get a new picture, so that's the one I'm going to stick with. I have my doctorate in public service leadership, my master's in health admin, and I have my bachelor's in accounting. I started my healthcare career in for-profit healthcare, first with Cogdell Spencer, now Cogdell Spencer Erdman, doing property management for them in South Carolina. Then my husband, who was in the Navy, got transferred and we moved to Florida, and I worked for HCA, and HCA owned 200 hospitals. And they were publicly traded when I worked for them. I managed 25 of those hospitals, Blue Cross, Medicare, and HMO discrepancy inventory. So I was in for-profit healthcare. Then I had a baby and decided I didn't want to work anymore and decided to work on my doctorate. And I was at a Mothers of Preschoolers event with my friend Sarah Nichols. We decided we wanted to solve the dental problems of Walworth County. You may not know this, but there's 13,000 people on Badger Care in Walworth County, and there's not a single dentist who accepts Badger Care in Walworth County. So all those residents we have to bus or transport to Milwaukee or Racine to get dental services. This is clearly a problem. We've also chosen to not fluoridate our water in many of those communities, which makes it even worse. So Sarah and I set out on this mission. We made a plan for a dental bus. And with that dental bus, we thought we would be able to help our community. We went around to all these CEOs and we said, hey, we got this great business plan. You should roll with it. And they said, no, thank you. And told us about a free clinic that was about to be started. So Sarah and I jumped on board 4 years ago and we helped found the Open Arms Free Clinic in Elkhorn. I don't know if any of you guys are familiar with that. Whitewater is half in Walworth County and half in Jefferson County. The Walworth County Free Clinic is Open Arms Free Clinic. The Jefferson County Free Clinics, there's one in Watertown, and then there's also one in Jefferson. So there's two free clinics. So if any of you guys are uninsured and need health assistance, you definitely have free clinics available to you in this area. So 4 years ago, Sarah and I got on board with helping to open up Open Arms Free Clinic. And we started with medical, and now 4 years later, Open Arms Free Clinic does have medical, does have dental, does have mental health services, has laboratory, has a vision line, has a pharmacy. It's a full service, one-stop shop. It's in the same building as the food pantry, so Open Arms is really able to collaborate with the food pantry to make sure that the food being provided there is beneficial to our patients. And it's really, really quite cool. So we've made our dental goal, right? We're helping people get access to dental insurance and dental coverage, and it's really exciting. So in that process, 2 years ago, the ACA was really getting revved up and starting. People were starting to have health insurance. And I had my students do a capstone project on who the free and charitable clinics patients were going to be post-ACA for Open Arms Free Clinic. And they established this strategic plan, and then I emailed it to all the free clinics in Wisconsin. And that was January of 2014. When I emailed that to everyone in Wisconsin, they said, this is really interesting. We should all get together. So we all got together. reviewed the plan and said, we need to meet more often. Let's form an association. So by November of 2014, we had established our association. We had our 501c3 status by February of 2015. We really spent the first year doing paperwork. When you form an organization, you have to do things like create your brand profile, create your strategic plan, tons of policies and procedures and employee handbooks. A lot goes into the first year of not doing anything other than paperwork, but we did make this documentary that you guys will watch. Lindsay Hammonds, who made the documentary, was on my board of directors. She was a medical college student at the time, and she was the board president of Saturday Clinic for the Uninsured, which is the student-run free clinic at the medical college. Her mom was retired 60 Minutes, and her dad was the retired cameraman for Dan Rather. So we got really lucky that they donated their services and created the documentary for us for free. So that was our really first big goal we did, and now we're working on a standards of excellence. So that's me. All right, true or false? Free and charitable clinics always have the word free or charitable in their name. False. Yes, it is false. Examples are Health Net of Rock County, which is in Janesville, St. Joseph's Medical Clinic, which is in Waukesha, Outreach Health Clinic, which is in Menominee Falls, and In-Health Community Health Clinic, which is in Boscobel. All right, another true or false. Free and charitable clinics are no longer needed post-ACA because everyone has health insurance. That is very false. The ACA is not. When I say ACA, that means Affordable Care Act or Obamacare. The ACA is not and never was intended to be universal health coverage. All right, so now we are going to show the documentary.
The latest casualty numbers are hard for any American to hear.
Now, this isn't the report card.
Jim McClure had been a journalist and a public relations executive.
I lived in the most affluent suburb in Chicago. And I had the life of the executive taking the commuter train home. I was the man in the gray flannel suit. Before that, I was the up-and-coming news reporter and anchor.
In Jim's spare time, he volunteered at a food pantry.
Not that long ago, I was handing out, you know, steaks and staples and food to women that were coming up crying whose husbands had just been laid off or who were suddenly divorced. And I remember saying to them as they were crying, you know, please, you don't have to apologize. Don't feel bad about this. I will probably need this someday. The shocking thing is I didn't believe it. The most shocking thing is that 5 years later I was living it.
The recession had hit the country.
Within the course of a year, I and so many other people lost it all. My job was gone, my career was gone.
To make ends meet, Jim took jobs as a car salesman and a security guard, but couldn't afford health insurance coverage, nor was he eligible for Medicaid, known in Wisconsin as Badger Care. And Jim could no longer ignore his health issues.
I was at the point where I said, I've got to get some help, and I read in the paper about my local clinic.
It became apparent to me that there was so little known about free clinics.
Dr. Julie Darnell has spent more than 10 years researching over 1,000 free and charitable clinics around the U.S., to understand what role it plays into our healthcare system for the uninsured and underinsured.
Collectively across the sector and together, all of those 1,000 or so clinics provided services to 2 million patients and provided 3.5 million medical and dental visits every year. So I think that was a surprise to many people that this fairly unknown member of the safety net did so much.
In March of 2010, President Obama signed the law for the Affordable Care Act.
We are done.
The law mandated that all 50 states use federal funds to expand Medicaid beyond the 100% federal poverty level up to 138%. Beyond that, people would need to buy insurance through the Affordable Care Act's insurance exchange. The Supreme Court overturned this law in 2012. ruling, states must have a genuine choice whether to accept Medicaid expansion. Presently, Wisconsin is among 17 states which have opted out.
The proposal I'm talking about today will reduce the number of uninsured people in this state by 224,580.
In 2013, Wisconsin had nearly 500,000 uninsured residents.
I want the funding that we provide to things like Medicaid to be for what it was meant for people who are poor. Well, not to be a permanent way of life, but to be a temporary hand up, not a permanent handout.
So the state of Wisconsin decided they would insure only up to 100% of poverty, and everybody else would have to go to the exchanges. The problem there is you're still very poor, between 100 and 138% of poverty, and they just cannot afford some of the copays and deductibles.
The exchanges under the Affordable Care Act provide a subsidy to make the healthcare exchange affordable to individuals and families who are part of that. If you're someone who just creeps over 100% of the federal poverty line, which means you move out of that category of poverty, if you're just above that, you're paying, about $19 a month as an individual for healthcare. Now, I realize when you're just above poverty, every dollar's difficult, but $19 isn't an unreasonable amount. We're not talking about hundreds of dollars. We're talking about less than 20 bucks to get health care under the exchange.
Jim landed in this just over the federal poverty line category and still couldn't afford insurance from the exchange.
I was transitioning off my paid medication, and I'd say, I got to let that go. I got to eat this week. You have to make that priority. When you're making those decisions, every day feels like musical chairs. What can I go without ending up falling down?
And that's when Jim turned to the Open Arms Free Clinic.
I felt like angels had actually flown down out of the heavens to pick me up. And I started sobbing the first time I came in. I am so happy that I finally arrived where people are going to take care of me. And it was very clear that I was being cared for.
One of the largest misconceptions after the passage of the Affordable Care Act is that every single American has access to affordable health insurance. Nothing could be farther from the truth.
In fact, many low-paid workers are caught in an insurance gap. Those that are not poor enough to qualify for Medicaid, yet still too poor to pay for insurance from the marketplace.
Here in Wisconsin, we know that there are still 8% of our population, or over 300,000 people, are uninsured. Many of our counties still are in the double digits. And so you're talking thousands of people in every community.
I'm here for blood pressure checkup.
Okay. Even with federal subsidies, why are people without insurance coverage? Well, there are many reasons, and here are only a few. A person might receive coverage through their employer, but the premiums can still be too expensive. Also, if someone gets a new job, there's typically a waiting time until insurance kicks in. This could be up to 3 months. And then people might have simply missed open enrollment and have to wait until the next enrollment period, which could be up to a year. And the list goes on.
We may have insured people in the United States, but we didn't teach them, hey, this is how you use insurance.
Because of difficulties and struggles, many of them are dropping out of the marketplace and coming back to our free clinic.
And so the key thing we learned is that there's a real big disconnect between just insuring someone and having someone be successfully insured and continue to receive the care that they got when they were at our free clinics.
How is successfully insured defined? Paying the premium, making an appointment with an in-network provider, seeing that network provider, and transferring all the medications.
We had a feeling that people were not being successful with their insurance because they started returning to our clinics, and we knew they weren't getting their medications like they should be, and we knew they were going back into the emergency rooms. And so we had a feeling, but we didn't realize it was as bad as we actually found.
Dr. Steve Hargarten is the chief of emergency medicine at Frederick Hospital in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Once the Affordable Care Act had passed, we have seen an increased census of patients coming to the emergency department for a variety of acute care reasons. And some of us have felt that it was partially due to the Affordable Care Act and its other ripple effects, which is patients have insurance now, but they have no medical home, and so they're sick and they come to the emergency department for resolution or answers for that problem.
Dr. Hargarten's observations correlates with this 2015 study prepared for the Emergency Medicine Action Fund. The study states the Affordable Care Act is expected to result in an increase in emergency department visits by 1.1 million, with those gaining Medicaid coverage accounting for over two-thirds of those visits. It goes on to say, given the lack of timely access for primary and specialty care, Medicaid patients may be even more reliant than other insured individuals on care by emergency medicine physicians. While more than 17 million people now have insurance due to the Affordable Care Act, getting an appointment with a primary care doctor can be difficult, sometimes waiting months. And this will only get worse as the shortage of doctors increases. The Association of American Medical Colleges estimates that by 2025, there will be a shortage of between 46 and 90,000 physicians. About one-third of these doctors would be primary care physicians. This doctor deficit makes the existence of free and charitable clinics even more critical, since waiting months for a doctor's visit isn't always an option.
We function as the patient's medical home. We treat acute and chronic conditions and have a large referral network that we can help patients with.
We see patients who come in with primary care issues like diabetes, hypertension, patients who have urgent needs, which could be chest pains, belly pains. So anybody who has medical issues, we will take care of them.
Free clinics don't receive any federal dollars. We are supported solely by grants and donations.
And we do provide medication for patients as well.
We still need dollars to operate our clinics. We still need medical supplies, dental supplies, in order to ensure that everybody is getting the care that they need.
Wisconsin has a total of 70 free and charitable clinics serving over 52 counties.
The difference between a free clinic, a charitable clinic, an FQHC, a hybrid clinic, there's sort of an alphabet soup of clinics.
Here's the breakdown. Free clinics do not charge for anything, neither doctor visits, medicines, and lab tests, nor do they charge for preventative dental services or any other specialty services. They are run only by volunteers, don't bill any third-party insurances, and depend solely on public donations and grants. Charitable clinics are similar to free clinics, except they may charge a flat or sliding fee for any of their services. It's possible the fee can be waived if the patient has no ability to pay. Again, they are run only by volunteers, don't bill a third-party insurance, and depend solely on public donations and grants. Hybrid clinics function much like a charitable clinic, typically using a sliding fee scale for services and medication. The difference here is that they are able to bill third-party insurances, Medicaid, Medicare, and any other private insurance. And like the free and charitable clinics, they only use volunteers and get their funding through public donations and grants. Finally, we have the Federally Qualified Health Center, or FQHC. FQHCs use a sliding fee scale for all services, including doctor visits, medicines, and clinical social workers. They may not pay for some lab services and medical equipment, but they will bill third-party insurance, and most of the staff is paid using federal funds and grants. Are we confused yet? Well, it could be for anybody with or without insurance walking through the doors of any of these clinics.
The Affordable Care Act was never intended to be a universal healthcare program. That is why free and charitable clinics remain so important as members of the safety net. And we continue to fill in the gaps of our current healthcare system.
Sarah Nichols is the executive director of the Open Arms Clinic in Walworth County.
So we've definitely gone beyond just the medical and the medicine. We've added the dental and we've added the vision. Now we offer mental health services here with 7 counselors.
We run a GYN clinic, we run a podiatry clinic, we run diabetic classes.
We have 2 specialists who come in periodically, a endocrinologist, and then we have a psychiatrist.
We now are able to offer physical therapy. We have a nephrologist that comes in, a hematologist, so we have many added services through the generosity of volunteers.
The Open Arms Free Clinic has more than 200 volunteers who have given up 6,500 hours. If these were paid staff, it would cost over $300,000 a year. And remember, this is only one clinic.
If the ACA is leading clinics to close at high rates. You'd expect that we'd find many more closures in the Medicaid expansion states. And what I've done with the 115 clinics that I know have closed, I've found that 58% of them are in a Medicaid expansion state, which means that 42% of them are not, which is further evidence that clinics are needed regardless of their location, Medicaid expansion state or non-Medicaid expansion state.
Our patients are not going anywhere anytime soon. The Affordable Care Act dramatically changed the healthcare system, but it necessarily didn't change our patients and the needs that they still have.
When I needed to get through, when I needed to keep going, when I needed to get my blood pressure regulated, all those things I was able to get at the free care clinic.
The clinic helped Jim get back on his feet.
Around the dinner hour on Friday evening, town of Geneva police.
I'm starting to have jobs again, partial time as a news reporter in radio and newspaper and magazine.
In Walworth County, Jim McClure, WGTD News.
Jim has now transitioned to insurance from the marketplace with the help from the Open Arms Free Clinic.
What Open Arms provided was a insurance expert right there. Having successfully made it out of this scary situation in my life and knowing that I really don't have to fear again because there are people out there willing to help. And when you meet somebody who works at a free clinic, you're meeting someone who's the best at what they do and the best at what a human being can be, and that is to love and care for another human being.
So that's a free clinic. Questions so far?
Did it help, or
Did it help? Yeah, so free and charitable clinics, we saw a lot of our patients become insured. So here in the state of Wisconsin, we expanded Medicaid, but we didn't. So before, we didn't take the full money, so we as taxpayers paid for our expansion. We now go to 100% of the federal poverty level. Before that, there were 150,000 single adults who didn't get Medicaid. And so in Wisconsin, we said, all right, we're going to go to 100%. So those 150,000 adults now got added to the system. So that was good. So those patients left us at the free clinics. but there's definitely things we could fix about the Affordable Care Act, but a lot more people got insurance and were able to get procedures. So when you look at the ACA and you think about the cost, and you hear a lot about the cost, it makes sense that it was so expensive the first couple of years, because you had an uninsured population. When you're uninsured, are you going to have a surgery? Are you going to have a biopsy? No, you're not. You're going to put it off, right? So we just insured 20 million people. They have years of tests and things they haven't had done, right? Now they have insurance. So what are they doing? Getting it done, right? So it's not surprising at all that the costs were so high the first couple years. We haven't given this program the chance to stabilize in the market. We're now, okay, now everyone's had their tests and everyone's had their surgery, so now the costs will stabilize. So before that happens, we're starting to change things again, so we're not gonna know. But yeah, the ACA helped thousands of people here in Wisconsin. In Walworth County, I wanna say we have 8,000 people. In Jefferson County, I think it's like 9,000 people enrolled in the marketplace. If you go to enrollamerica.org, you can get county-specific statistics. But these are people who didn't have health insurance. I've helped numerous people. For instance, I had one lady, she had insurance, but before the ACA, we didn't have max out-of-pockets. So one of the things the ACA says is once you hit $6,700, you don't owe any additional money. And this lady, she had had a baby, and the baby was in a NICU, and her bill was $250,000. Before the ACA, you had straight 80-20 plans, so she owed 20% of $250,000. She owed $50,000, right? If the ACA had been in place, she would have owed $6,700 because we have max out-of-pockets now because of the ACA. So she had to declare bankruptcy. If the ACA had been in place, she told me I could have just done a fundraiser and raised $6,700 or put it on a credit card. You can't come out of $50,000, you can come out of $6,700. So I've had situations like that. I've had situation where there was farmers who were uninsured because they had pre-existing conditions and the insurance was something like $3,500 a month, and now we got them in the marketplace paying $300 or $400 a month. So there were there's some definite good things about it. Are there things we could fix? Yes. But I think overall, the people it benefited were very grateful. So, all right, so a gap does remain. In theory, there should be no uninsured, but this just isn't the way it is. We have these huge gaps that exist. I'm gonna jump ahead to show you where they exist. Okay, so there's people who find their employer coverage unaffordable. If you have affordable coverage available to you through your employer, you are not eligible for assistance in the marketplace. And the marketplace is healthcare.gov. Everyone say .gov. Okay, .gov, this is very important. There's a healthcare.com, it's a spam website. Yeah, really wonderful. That's the big problem we've had in the free clinics. Our patients had thought they bought insurance, no. They've bought non-compliant plans that don't cover anything. And a huge problem with our population is you have financial illiteracy combined with health illiteracy. And when you put those together, you have health insurance illiteracy. So people have been going to healthcare.com instead of healthcare.gov. They get wrong information. They get spammed. All right, so if your employer offers you insurance that is affordable, in quotation marks, that means you have individual insurance available to you that is 9.56% of your salary or less. Know what I said? Individual insurance. So here's an example. We have this family and they make $47,000 a year. And insurance is available to the employee at $196 a month. This is affordable because it's 5% of his income, and 5% is less than 9.56, okay? This family is considered to have affordable coverage available to them because the individual plan is less than that. But you can see the premium for the family plan is $509 a month, 13% of their income. But do they have affordable coverage? Yes, because of the way we defined it. So this would be something where we would fix the Affordable Care Act is how we define affordability. So affordability is based solely on premiums and is not based on copays or deductibles, and it's defined based on individual. So what we've seen a lot in the free clinics is one spouse will have the insurance and then the other spouse will be uninsured because they can't afford the family premium. So that's one example. So when I say find family coverage unaffordable, all right, they can't enroll in Medicaid. If you are a legal resident but you haven't lived here for 5 years, you can't get Medicaid. If you qualify for Medicaid, that means you make under 100% of the federal poverty level, which is around $12,000. You don't get any assistance at healthcare.gov unless you're above 100% of the federal poverty level. We have people who are exempt from the mandate. Because here in Wisconsin we didn't expand our Badger Care to 138% of the federal poverty level, everyone from 100 to 138 is exempt from the penalty. It's hard to motivate people without the penalty sometimes. And I help people do insurance enrollment, and since the executive order came down that the penalties might not be enforced, we saw a huge decline in people signing up for insurance, which is really too bad. Because if you don't have insurance, you don't have that max out-of-pocket limit. Like, a big benefit of insurance is the max I will ever owe is $6,700. If you're uninsured, you go into that hospital, you're gonna owe total charges, right? There's no max out-of-pocket limit for you. There's people who file taxes separately from their spouse. So these are people getting divorces. If they file separately, no assistance at the marketplace. People caught in the difference of income determination. Marketplace figures it based on a year. Badger Care figures it based on a month. If you're a seasonal employee, I live in Lake Geneva. We have a lot of people who work at the hotel, so they make lots of money in the summer, And then do they make lots of money now? No, they don't. And so their income for the whole year is $9,000, so they don't qualify for healthcare.gov, but their monthly income in the summer is too high to qualify for Badger Care. So we see situations like this. So there's lots of little loopholes, and they're all little teeny tiny niches. It's not an easy explanation to explain who the uninsured are. And only the marketplace has premium caps based on income. If your employer is offering you coverage, it doesn't take into account what your income is, other than it has to be less than 9.56% for the individual premium. If your employer offers you coverage, no subsidies. All right, so on your handout, I gave you this budget, and this shows you what a person with a so-called high income, how much they can actually afford coverage. $30,000 a year is $15 an hour. You know, there's a push right now to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. So this would be a budget for someone if we increase that. So you can see here, we have the person's salary. Then they pay their taxes. We want them to be a responsible person, so they should be contributing to their 401k. Then they have premiums on their rent or their home or their cars. Then life insurance premiums, because once again, this should be a responsible adult. This is this person's everyday life, okay? This isn't like I'm waiting to have something better. It's an everyday life making $30,000. Gas to and from work, car payment, maintenance, yeah, have food and household items such as toilet paper, rent or mortgage, energy, water, trash. I did a cell phone with internet because you have to have internet nowadays for looking for jobs, for responding to inquiries within your business. And then I'm super kind and gave this person $120 a year for entertainment. That's going out to eat there and everything. This is Netflix, Hulu, whatever. And how much money do they have for healthcare? A negative $1,000. This really rich person making $30,000 has a negative $1,300 to go to healthcare. This person is so rich that they don't qualify for food share, they don't qualify for housing allowances or anything like that. Okay, so we got this negative $1,300. The ACA says based on their income, they owe 6.8% of their salary for health insurance. So that's a $2,000 premium, a deductible of $2,500. This person has some chronic conditions. They have high blood pressure, need some blood pressure meds. They have some anxiety, need some Lexapro. So that's $720 a month plus dental insurance. They're in the hole $8,000 by the end of the year for health, if they want to have anything to do with health care. So, is healthcare affordable for this person? Yes? No? No. No, healthcare is not affordable for this person. This would be someone we would serve at our free clinic. This is a working person who has chosen to be uninsured, not because they're irresponsible, but because clearly there's what? No funds. There's no funds available for this person to spend on healthcare. Okay, so why do we have an association? Why do you think associations exist? Anyone? I'll give you a hint.
Are you like a union for health clinics?
Okay, so yeah, I guess we could base kind of like a union. We're the voice. Yeah, we're the voice for free and charitable health clinics. So we help the clinics because they are so focused on their missions. Free and charitable clinics are run by volunteers, and when they're there, they're all about just providing that care for that patient. They don't have a lot of time to be looking at what laws are being passed, what are all the changes that are happening in the healthcare system, what doing the community needs assessments, looking at all those things. So as a free and charitable clinic association, I work at understanding the laws and telling them what's going on. I look at what are trends in the industry and how that impacts them. And then I also try to bring in resources and other speakers to help them do better care. So this last month, I brought in the AIDS Resource Center to talk about how to do needle exchanges as a way for us to help fight the opiate epidemic. All right, so our mission is to support, strengthen, and advocate for the uniqueness of the Wisconsin Free and Charitable Clinic, the patients they serve, and the communities with whom they partner. So that's our role as an association. That's what we are trying to do. There's 70 free and charitable clinics in Wisconsin. 49 of them are members of our clinic. You guys are going to be developing a survey for those free clinics. We've been in existence, like I said, for 2 years. We want to know, are our members happy with our services? Do they find value in what we're doing? Do they like the newsletters? Do they like the newsletters? Do they like the monthly phone calls? What speakers, topics do they want to hear about? What more could we do? What's working? What's not working? That's what you're really thinking about and trying to help me understand is how can I best serve my customer? And my customer is the free clinic, not the free clinic patient, but the actual free clinic itself. So that's what you'll think about. We offer a membership-only section on our website. We have summits twice a year. We offer collaboration opportunities. Members of our association, which it only costs $100 to belong to our association. That might be something you could ask them too. Would you pay more? Because we would like to have more money. That might be something. Where is the line? If we offered this additional service, is that worth money to you? Are we charging a reasonable rate for our summits? Would you pay more to attend a summit? Things like that are all things we want to understand. So our state currently does not receive any funding, our association, from the state. So we are not a line item on the state budget. We are not a line item on the federal budget. There are 17 other free and charitable clinic associations in the United States, and some of them receive money already. I've done this research for you. Ask Max to put this presentation up for you. All right, so I set it up in this way here. I gave you guys the link to that association's website, and then I explained the different things about that association. So Florida, for example, has over 100 clinics, and they get $10 million appropriated to them from the government. Okay, so the state gives them $10 million, and then these are all the different area things they have to do for that $10 million. Now clearly Florida can have higher dues than me, right? Because what are they giving the free clinics?
$10
million, right, yeah, exactly. So Virginia gets money too. So the Virginia Association, they get $6.5 million. They charge every free clinic $1,200 to be a member of their association. And then that clinic in return gets $150,000, right? If I had $150,000 to give everyone, I bet they would give me $1,200, right? But I don't. I have newsletters, seminars, and myself, the volunteer. So I have limited resources, but I would still like to know what can I give to them with limited resources, and what if we started getting resources? Where and what would the free clinics like to see from us? So this is to give you guys a little bit of background on the different associations that exist and the funding that they get. These are some other associations that don't receive state funding if you wanted to research them. Sorry, I did not put their websites on this one. You'll have to look it up yourself. All right, there's also some other safety net associations. So there's the Primary Healthcare Association. They help only the FQHCs. FQHCs is a specific designation from the government. Free and charitable clinics are not FQHCs. This is actually a huge misconception in the public. People think we're the same thing, and we're not. An FQHC, you have to have a designated health resource shortage area in your community, which is usually defined by poverty level. So where I live in Walworth County, we cannot have an FQHC because we have a median income of $46,000. That's too high. But we know we have a lot of poverty, and we know we have uninsured. Lake Geneva School District has a 62% free and reduced lunch. So if there's no poverty, why are 62% of the children on free and reduced lunch? That doesn't make sense. So there is poverty. The median income isn't a very good indicator of if there's poverty in a community. I think when you look at free and reduced lunch, and maybe when you guys are doing your research, it's really a good indicator of poverty, is free and reduced lunch versus median incomes. All right, so there can only be so many FQHCs because of this health resource designation. Free and charitable clinics, we can be anywhere a community wants to have them. Then the other association is the Planned Parenthood and Family Planning Clinics, and that's called WIFRA. So we are all different. We are all part of the safety net, but we have to collaborate and work together. So those are the other associations. And then I wanted to invite all of you to our June 2nd Uninsured Summit, where you can learn more about free clinics and you can see me handing out these surveys you're going to create. Questions for me? Yeah. That I personally need solved or that my free clinics need solved?
For the free clinics.
Okay. So there's a couple of them. Obviously, funding is an issue for us. We struggle with being able to care for our patients and then provide them with free medications at the same time because generic costs are going up. And if you are an undocumented resident, we can't get you prescription assistance programs, and some health systems won't give charity care to undocumented residents. So that's a problem. Another problem is volunteer recruitment, finding volunteers and getting them to stay. And then, so we did medications, volunteers, funding. Just general funding. Yeah. Yeah.
What keeps a normal person who has insurance, let's say, they have insurance, what keeps them from going to the free clinic? Like, is there like a background check? Is there some sort of system that says, oh, this person has insurance?
No, you have to be honest. Okay. And really, if someone's coming to a free clinic, more times than not, they're not taking advantage of the system. Some free clinics will see people with insurance. They'll categorize them as underinsured. but it's kind of on your honor. If you have Medicaid, we can find that out pretty easy. Because we'll be like, oh, your income is low, so we're going to apply for Medicaid, and then we find out you already have Medicaid. But for other people, we'd ask for a copy of your most recent pay stub, usually, or a tax return to verify income. And then they serve based on that. But not all clinics go based on income. So the East Troy Free Clinic, they'll see you whether you're insured or uninsured, and they don't care about your income. You just show up. Open Arms Free Clinic, you have to be uninsured and under 200% of the federal poverty level. Rock River Free Clinic in Jefferson, they go up to 400% of the federal poverty level, and you have to be uninsured. So it really depends on the individual clinic and what they feel their community needs. But it's on your honor, and we kind of figure if you need health care, I mean, you wouldn't be going there if you didn't have to, right? Yeah.
Can you only go to that clinic if you're like a member of the county?
It depends on the clinic. So some clinics are open to anyone. Open Arms Free Clinic, you have to be in Walworth County or work in Walworth County. Rock River Free Clinic in Jefferson and Watertown Area Cares County have split Jefferson County, so then it's based on where you live. But some of them, there's like the one in Dodgeville, you can come from anywhere and they will see you. So they end up actually seeing a lot of people from Iowa too. Yeah.
I think we kind of went over this, but are Medicaid and Affordable Care Act the same thing?
No.
Okay, can you explain it?
Okay, so the Affordable Care Act is your healthcare.gov, yes, okay, your healthcare.gov, and that's 100 to 400% of the federal poverty level. So it would go, Badger Care is here, and Badger Care is Medicaid. Okay, so this is for adults mostly, okay? And then from 101 to 400, it's .gov, okay? And then children get Medicaid up to 300%. That's a child. Okay. So the Affordable Care Act asked all states to expand their Medicaid to 138% of the federal poverty level. Our state said, no, we're only going to do 100 because the marketplace begins at 101. So in theory, no one should be uninsured. But the reality is people are uninsured. Does that make help?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Also, we have a library.
Yeah, yeah.
But on the other hand, Dr. Catherine Nauke is so knowledgeable, so it has to be open for two more questions. And you or you can have questions.
Yes.
I'm just curious, you listed a lot of questions for the survey. I was wondering if you have like one major like desire for question one of the others.
Like, yeah, oh, I don't have any specific questions in mind so much as I just really want to know like, what do they value? What for $100, what do they want to see? And in their perceptions, are they getting their $100 worth from us or not? What more could we do? What less could we do? I really want to know what kind of speaker topics would they like to have. Are we giving them the speakers they want to hear?
And also, like Dr. Kaufman mentioned, that the 49 are the neighbors, so you have that being also, you know, another like 21 or 20 something are not. So maybe we can learn something from this and then try to solicit or encourage other non-member to become a member.
Right. So when we form the association, there were 7 clinics who were opposed to forming the association because they were concerned that then the government would start regulating free and charitable clinics. Now, if you accept Medicaid, the government can regulate you. If you accept Medicare, the government can regulate you. But because we don't actually accept any insurance, we don't have a joint commission or anything like that, which is why the association is developing standards right now to self-regulate. Kind of like in your Sarbanes-Oxley law, you know, it applies to for-profit organizations, but not for profits. We still try to do Sarbanes-Oxley law so that we don't get regulated.
One more?
Oh, yeah.
I have another one, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay, so you said you don't accept Medicaid. Why? I'm sorry, I feel like you said that too, but why?
Okay, well, first off, we're run by volunteers.
Right.
So if you're going to accept Medicaid, you have to have certain policies and procedures in place. And then you start dealing with the issue of volunteer liability coverage and billing Medicaid with utilizing volunteers and having consistent medical home. And if you're labeled a medical home, you have to have a 24-hour hotline. And how are you going to man that with a volunteer staff? And so Medicaid significantly underpays. So for example, if you spend $1 on a Medicaid patient, you're going to get 2 cents. You know, you lose money on every Medicaid patient. Why do no dentists in Walworth County accept Medicaid? Because Medicaid pays $8 for a dental cleaning and $25 for an x-ray. Can you make a business model where you're going to make money paying your dentist $90,000 a year and your hygienist $45,000 a year where you get paid $8 a teeth cleaning? Yeah.
Good question.
Yeah.
All right. So because of time, I think we should...
All right. So, and I have my card and the documentary up here. So if you get more questions, there's no dumb questions. They're all good questions. The healthcare system is very complicated. So send me any questions and then the documentary and my card. Okay.
And also I will put the PowerPoint on YouTube.